Aloha, ladies and germs. Welcome to the experience. I'm your host, Jeremy Vaeni, and this week is a solo show. I wanted to do one with my honey pie, Carol, about all of our wedding vows celebration shenanigans. But we've been dealing with a sick cat, so we haven't really had enough sleep to be coherent enough to do that show. So I will do a solo episode this week. I hope everyone has enjoyed their turkey and tofurkey, their giving thanks, and their giving lectures about Thanksgiving being a terrible holiday. Whatever it is that you do on Thanksgiving, hope all of that went just splendidly for you. I had an idea, and I'll run it by you, and you can tell me in the comments, subscribers. And non-subscribers, you can write to me, Jeremy@unknowncountry.com, and tell me what you think about every now and then doing episodes, or even beginning episodes, I don't know, with giving commentary to some of the news items on the front page of unknowncountry.com. I thought maybe those would be good jumping off points for just riffing a little bit. So if that appeals to you, if the thought of that appeals to you, let me know. And I will start doing that. In fact, I will start doing that right now, just so you can get a taste of it, I suppose. But right now, I'm looking at the latest news item, and Whitley's got there, a dark warning on Black Friday. National Climate Assessment warns of the dangers of ignoring global warming. And, you know, this story has permeated the mainstream, of course. And isn't it interesting how a story like that, you used to only be able to get that on unknowncountry.com, and it's very specific links. You know, like Unknown Country rewrites stories sometimes for their news feed and or takes an amalgamation of sources and, you know, creates articles that way. But so these sources would, as far as climate change goes, would be very specific, very specialized. They'd be from specialized websites. And now it's become this mainstream thing. Now all of a sudden, I mean, we've talked about this before in other ways, but I just find it intriguing that we now, I think at this point, we have a way to gauge just how long it takes for a super important, life-changing, you know, Earth life-changing news item to make it out of obscurity, and just what it takes for it to do that. Because, you know, I mean, Whitley's been talking about this since he wrote Nature's End, right? But then really hunkered down with the coming global superstorm. The span between those two books is, I don't even know what, a decade, more than a decade? So the global warming problem, you know, it's been known about since at least the 70s. But then it took at least another decade to sort of trickle into people wanting to sound the alarm in any sort of way, small way. And then at least another decade for it to become, you know, this sort of building of almost a subculture of people, or a, you know, if you want to call it the quote unquote far left or the progressive left or whatever that is, to really latch onto this story. Although, ironically, through Al Gore, he's the one who gets the credit, right? And he is certainly not far left by any stretch. He's middle of the road left. But okay, so Al Gore, and then there's the pushback by the right at behest of the oil companies, who are doing their best to repress the science and pretend that nothing's going on here. And then we do that for another decade, right? Another decade or two. And on the long end of the spectrum, what, about 40 years? Between 40 and 50 years is what it takes for us to care. And on the short end of the spectrum, you could say maybe arguably like 30 years. Unless you're counting from the Global Superstorm book and Al Gore, An Inconvenient Truth came out in 2006. So that's about 12 years, right? Where we just start to care. So between 40 years and 12 years, somewhere in there, when there's something that could potentially change all life as we know it, or destroy human societies, be a genocidal factor in insects and animals, that takes decades. It takes years for us to care in any meaningful non-subculture, not being pushed at you by a progressive left or right way. The mainstream. Why is that?
We'll be back after this.
Aloha, Jeremy Vaeni here, and I want to tell you about my latest undertaking, OurUndoing.com. OurUndoing.com is a multimedia website where if you watch, if you read, if you listen, without trying to absorb knowledge like we do with normal learning, and without the normal judgmental filters that we use to compare and contrast so-called spiritual knowledge, if we watch, if we read, if we listen without all of that, we may just wake up to our full human nature. That is what this website is for. It's not about what we're doing, it's about who we are, truly are, when we're off the pendulum of duality. If your life is about seeking truth above all else, look no further. Join me at OurUndoing.com.
Whitley Strieber has published an incredible 2-volume historical novel called In Hitler's House, under his open pseudonym Jonathan Lane. This amazing story follows the life of William Weber, who meets Hitler while touring Germany in 1931 and becomes his friend and confidant, but then, when he realizes the truth, becomes a spy in Hitler's house for the Allies. Living a life of terrible danger, he falls in love with another of Hitler's secret friends, also a spy in his house. This is a story of espionage and desperate love, and the deepest portrait of Adolf Hitler ever created. Don't miss In Hitler's House, available in paperback and as an ebook on Amazon.
Welcome back.
And there's a book series called Project Censored, The News That Didn't Make the News, and they do, every year they release this book, Project Censored, the 25 news stories, big news stories that didn't make the news, that were just sort of in a local paper here and there, but didn't break the mainstream, that are super important. And just to give you an example, one of these was Project Harp, before everybody jumped aboard the Project Harp conspiracy bandwagon. Well, those of us who read Project Censored knew all about it. Mad cow disease is another one. That was, before it became a huge breaking item in the news, Project Censored covered it and said, we need to focus on this, guys. And then, like, within a year, maybe 2 years, it became huge breaking news in both instances. And in the Project Harp instance, I mean, it became sort of a huge conspiracy thing. I don't know. What would you call that? Idea that takes flight. So Project Harp and mad cow disease are, mad cow disease is terrible, and Project Harp is potentially terrible, at least intriguing in a terrible way. but neither of those are what global warming is. And so why do things like that take 2 years, but the big terrible things take us forever? And this gets me to the bigger question, which is, why are we okay with killing ourselves? I mean, whether it comes to nuclear bombs or global warming or perpetual war for perpetual peace or perpetual war for perpetual energy or abandoning the trashed planet to go terraform another planet or creating artificial intelligence that could take us over, or the very fact that, our fears of artificial intelligence taking us over mimic exactly what is happening with how we feel about world leadership, that we have these political leaders who are out of our hands, out of our control. We barely even vote them into office anymore. This just, you know, here in America, at least, people paying attention see that their vote matters in some way. But even when you say that, there's going to be someone who comes back and says, yes, but the real structure, the secret government, the ones who really control everything. And whether they're right or wrong, we can't know that exists, right? But we can know that the fear is there, and that there is this pervasive sense of we're being led by other human beings who were born into this world just as we were and raised probably differently than we were, but that they're all sort of dictators, and that they're all, it's all out of our hands. And the nuclear stuff and the global warming, that's out of our hands. That's corporations, big evil faceless entities run by the 1%. But if you look back, you see that this sense of like creating something that's awful and putting it out into the world, and then supporting it or ignoring it until it becomes such a big thing that it's out of our hands. That's something that seems to be pervasive in our culture. So we have a role in that, even if it is out of our hands. The role is we bought the propaganda that we shouldn't have to support it until it was out of our hands, right? Or we ignored it and didn't care until suddenly it affected us, right? The selfishness thing. We don't pay attention to it, or we rah, rah, rah behind the evil overlords, thinking, you know, one day we can be one of them if we just appease them, but then it affects us. The chickens come home to roost, and suddenly we're all on board together. When do we stop doing that? What does it take to stop doing that? What does it take to hear that there is something happening right now that we're seeing the effects of, right? In California, we've got the wildfires. That's the most immediate, obvious thing. And the giant tornadoes and the giant hurricanes and all that. I mean, we see it and we experience it, but we continue to turn a blind eye in any way that, you know, matters. And we do that because we say, well, we've got this structure, we've got this system, and we've got these leaders in place. And so if you want real change, you got to vote them out. And it's like, well, so we got to wait another couple of years to get someone else. And like, why aren't we just taking care of it? Why aren't we in the streets about this? Why don't we care? How did it get to this place in the first place? And I know there's some of you out there who probably want this to be completely unrelated to the visitor phenomenon and all that stuff. But let's hearken back. Let's take you back, shall we? I mean, to the master of the key who said what he said to Whitley Strieber in a hotel room. And then that became, of course, the basis for the work for the coming global superstorm. Or the impetus to write it with Art Bell, right? So we can't ignore that the paranormal has guided this vessel in some way. And prior to that, of course, Whitley wrote Nature's End way back when. And while Nature's End was a work of fiction, and while Whitley did not know about this visitor phenomenon through, you know, that had permeated his life. He wasn't conscious of it at that point. Can we separate the two? It was there. And how many other experiencers have we talked about on this show that who even if they've had hypnosis, even if they've had imparted into them a narrative of evil, malevolent, or just uncaring alien doctors doing experiments to them, they come out the other side of that quote-unquote memory retrieval, that most likely, at least partially false memory retrieval. But they come out of that narrative with an ending that doesn't make sense to the narrative, which is loving nature, caring about the earth, where we're going, all of that. Now, I'm sure that doesn't happen all the time, but it happens enough of the time that it is noteworthy. So it wouldn't be very difficult for me to believe that whether we understand what this phenomenon is in our lives, whether we're conscious of it yet, or whether we've come conscious but aren't clear because we've smothered it with a false narrative, the truth of it is always there. The kernel of what's going on is always there under the surface, whether we're conscious of it or not, whether we're blocking it out accidentally through other narratives or not. And perhaps that does change us, right? Perhaps that is the narrative that we're actually following, whether we consciously know it or not. It's possible. And we'll get back to that. But let's stick with this. I just want to know, why are we so okay with suicide? Why are we so complacent in our own, including the death of the planet? And this is regardless of whether, like someone like Teokas and Ghost Horse would say, we don't have to rescue the planet because the planet, you know, Mother Earth doesn't need rescuing. She's doing what she's going to do, and she'll take care of it, you know, when she's ready, right? She may just say flick to our society or to humanity or whatever. And true though that may be, the fact of the matter is also that so many of us do believe that we need to save the planet, do believe that we are destroying the planet, do believe that it's all out of our control, but we've got to do something about it at this late hour, but whatever we come up with isn't going to be enough, or isn't going to turn the tide. And so, given that narrative is our narrative, why is it? Like, whether it's true or not, why do we think that we're killing ourselves and basically allowing it to happen? Or why do we believe that we're destroying the planet itself or herself? And that's okay. I mean, it's just okay enough to not do anything about. Why is that us? Why are we antithetical to our own lives? And I wonder if this isn't, you know, with Our Undoing and .com and Our Undoing Radio, cheap plug, you know, talk about the fear of death, really the fear of annihilation of self, which is the bottom line for most of our problems. And I wonder if we don't deal with that en masse, if we're so disconnected from right relationship in the world with each other, with animals, with minerals, with go down the list, with organisms and life. If we're so disconnected from that, that we have to break through that delusional, disconnected person to even reconnect and be relational, to then be, you know, understand oneness. We've got that extra step to go through that heart cultures, native cultures don't. Then in that little delusional sphere that we call Western civilization, where right is might and arguments are everything, is that sphere, which is comprised of selves blanketed in darkness to their own true nature. Is that suicidal impulse? Because when so many of them come together and they're all internally, unconsciously screaming at themselves to wake up, but that gets, you know, it gets reinterpreted. It goes through the filters of culture and personal, and it comes out a voice saying, you're not enough, you've got a hole to fill, right? So the voice is authentically saying, wake up. It's you telling yourself to wake up, but it comes out as like a depression, like you've got a hole to fill. You've got to keep consuming things. You've got to keep doing. You've got to keep going. You've got to figure it out. And all it is wake up, not do anything, not get depressed and feel a hole. Say a billion people do that. A billion people live like that. Do they misinterpret wake up, which is essentially the death of self, for kill yourself, essentially suicide? And because it's an unconscious impulse that's being misinterpreted, do they / we act on it and not know it? And tell ourselves, no, we're fighting the good fight. Or, no, that's all just scientific mumbo-jumbo. It's really just propaganda from the left.
We'll be back after this.
The new unknowncountry.com is on the way. There'll be exciting new graphics, much easier navigation, the ability to subscribe either with your credit card or using PayPal, the return of our free message board and subscriber chat room, and so much more. The new site will be intuitive and easy to use, but it will also be demonstrated and explained on Whitley's YouTube channel. As to when, well, we're hopefully just weeks away.
You know, The Afterlife Revolution is a funny book. It makes people happy, even though it's about the afterlife and thinking about crossing over. It made me happy to write it. And the reason it did was that I was actually in touch with Anne while I was writing it. And not only that, she proved it. She proved it clearly and completely. When you read the book, you'll see what I mean. You'll see why Dr. Gary Schwartz, who is one of the leading experts on the afterlife, considers it such an important book, why he wrote a foreword for it. Because this is about something real and incredible that we are told every day not to believe that we have souls and that we have an afterlife. Well, we do. We do. And The Afterlife Revolution is going to open the door for you, so you're not going to be thinking to yourself, maybe I don't, when you do. And that's why it's a book of joy. Go on Amazon, take a look at the great reviews, and get yourself a copy. It's available for your Kindle, it's available in paperback, and there's an audiobook read by me. And let me tell you something. You can hear something in my voice. People tell me that, and I think it's true. You know what it is? It's the inner joy that is part of me and has become part of me since this extraordinary thing happened. I have to say, Anne Strieber was a remarkable person in this life, and she still is. Get it today.
Whitley Strieber's nonfiction is magical, powerful, and thought-provoking. From Communion to The Afterlife Revolution, there is no body of work like it in the world. Nothing even approaches it. And not only that, his wonderful fiction, from The Wolfen to his latest novel, New, offers reading and listening entertainment that you will never forget. And where do you find all this in one place? At Strieber.com. That's where. Every Whitley Strieber book available for sale is there. So don't wait. Go to Strieber.com and start exploring. There's only one Whitley and only one place to find all his work. Strieber.com.
Welcome back.
All of these dialogues that we have, pro or con, something that is definitely absolutely happening and going to wipe us out if it sees itself to its conclusion, whether it's nuclear, whether it's... Go down the list. Global warming is now the flavor of the day and is perhaps out of our hands, right? But we let it happen. And we tell ourselves that it's just natural progression. You know, in terms of AI, right, this natural progression is literally in our hands. But if we don't do it, someone else will. Can't stop progress. So our sense of progress is into death traps. We are progressing ourselves into death traps. And is that not because, again, we hear wake up, we don't know what we're hearing, We hear death of self. We think suicide. And we end up in a situation where we've got societies all working together on various levels, on creative projects, from weapons to computers, to sly conspiracies to cover up scientific truths, you know, to the average Joe at home and Jane who think, what can I do about it? It's not about what you can or can't do about it. It's that the impulse to say that in the face of calamity on this giant level, and to not change until it affects you personally, is all that about this little tiny voice that is you saying wake up and misinterpreting it? I wonder. And so if there is an intelligence, if there are beings who are so awakened, do they know how to work us on some level that sort of guides us to understand our own filters through which we listen? And the thing that would be genius about how they're doing this would be that they're able to do it no matter what we think about them, whether we think they're aliens, whether we think they're demons, whether we think that through our hypnotically retrieved memory, we were crying jello mush piles in front of them, whether we believe they're space brothers. It doesn't matter what narrative we foist upon them or how we do it through conscious recollection or unconscious, you know, retrieval, broken memory retrieval. Somehow, some way, whatever they're doing, through us, the outcome is the same. An awakening into the recognition of the preciousness of life. Perhaps they are awakening Western man, Western mind, Western woman out of this sense of separate self-solitude back into relationship. Relationship with nature. Relationship with other people who respect relationship. Which is not the same as oneness, but it's closer. It's proper and proportional and healthy within global consciousness. I mean, isn't it odd that we're globally awake, right? And we say that that's largely thanks to media and the internet. Now we understand the plight of people in other countries and they us and, you know, all of that. Although not completely true, because there's tons of quote-unquote third world countries where the citizens don't have the internet or TV or any of this stuff. They don't have phones. But okay, in our prejudiced mind where the whole world reflects us and how we live, the whole world is a global citizenship. But that global citizenship, that global consciousness, is an artificial construct. Real global is to be connected with, in and as, Mother Earth, right? That interconnection, not the internet connection. And if nothing else, through being an experience or a visitor phenomena, it seems as though a good portion of us become sensitive to that or become more better interconnected, regardless of our upbringing, regardless of our culture. And so first contact, if you want to call it that, which would only be first for us on a conscious societal level, but personally, at least some of us, maybe many of us, are already having whatever that is, contact, relationship. It's that first contact isn't going to be about aliens landing. It's not going to be about government disclosure. It can't happen until the mind has changed, until the mind has been led from delusion, until we've seen our way out of our own cave. And I don't even think these beings are giving us a flashlight. I think they are pointing us in a direction, and invisibly, every time we take a wrong turn, you know, those of us that they are engaged with, they invisibly slap you until you turn, because you don't want to go the way you're being beat, right? It's like this invisible sort of bumper cars pummeling to get you to go in a straight line, but you're in bumper cars, and you know how hard it is to go in a straight line in a bumper car? And in the dark, no less. So I think this is the type of guidance, if you want to call it that, where before I was sort of hoping, I guess, in my life that this kind of guidance would be about creating equals so that we can be in right relationship with whoever they are. That there is something universal about sentience. There's a ceiling to it. And when you wake up, you're in the fullness of it. Whether you're here or on Zeta Reticuli or in another universe, whatever it is awareness through and through. Wholeness is wholeness. It can't be a wholeness here and a different wholeness somewhere else. There's got to be the one giant umbrella in which wholeness is wholeness, no matter where you are. But perhaps that's a lofty goal. And perhaps such an intelligence would be, at a base minimum, simply trying to get us to wake up out of the suicidal voice and into the interconnection that is more truly us than the separate self. Because waking up, while it can all happen at once and be spontaneously, boom, there you are, if you look at that flash of a moment, it's not actually one thing. It's not, boom, one jump into the other. It's what you would call a process. It's the entirety of that process happening, you know, within a second, let's say. So the process is the process, either way. But it can happen in a second, or it can happen over the span of a million years. And however long you procrastinate, however long you remain unconscious, however long you misinterpret the voice, all along the way of the process, however much you interject yourself, is how long that process is going to take. You are determining whether you wake up in a flash, if reincarnation is true, over several lifetimes. If it is not true, whether you wake up at all in this lifetime or not. But either way, there's the process, right? So they can't just instantaneously wake us up in a flash. They can't snap their fingers and voila, wholeness. Humans are whole. But they can perhaps guide us to heed the call and remember what we are. And if we're not going to wake up into wholeness, well, at least wake up into interconnection, into true interconnecting as beings of Earth, beings on and with Earth. And then next comes the conundrum of, okay, now I'm that person, but I don't live in that culture, and I still live in a disconnected society, so what to do, what to do? And then on we go trying to figure that out. We go on shamanic retreats, and we screw ourselves up in other ways, right? Because we're looking for that. We're looking for the out. We're looking for, okay, now I'm sort of awake-ish. I feel more hearty than brainy. I feel more interconnected than separate. But what do I do? Because I don't live in that culture. My neighbors are still asleep in a way that I'm not. I know I'll go on these retreats and I'll do all of these exploratory journeying things and all of that, and then those become, unfortunately, another distraction, and they elongate the process of waking up. They become another way to be asleep. One eye open is still half asleep. Someone on Twitter posted to me a recent article from Graham Hancock talking about how many years it's been since he's done ayahuasca, and he went back and did it and at this retreat center and how great it was, love and light and yada yada. And that's good. It's always good to have a personal psychological sense of discovery and all of that. But if you come back to you and it's just a vacation, then you're not fundamentally changed. It's not your being. It's something that you're doing, and then you're coming back and feeling good about it. And maybe you are incrementally changed, but if you can take years off of that incremental change, then that's not waking up. And I don't know that we have time for that anymore, because we have brought death to our door, and I think we've brought death to our door precisely because we're not waking up quick enough. I mean, I don't know that there's an outside timetable. I just think, like, if society gets to be global, you know, or this mindset gets to be a global mindset of suicidal wrongness, well, you've set the timer on your own demise. Unless you change that, it can't hold. It can't sustain itself because it's global and it's billions of people. So there is no time to do spiritual shamanic retreats anymore, people. We've got to wake up. It's not enough to just feel good about something or, you know, to say, wow, you know, DMT is really just what an amazing, it's a portal into other places and other beings. And, well, that's wonderful. But you're still a jerk, right? Like, you still come back to yourself and you've got to deal with being a jerk. There is no enlightenment there. Except you feel good for a little bit. And you know that there's more to life than what you previously believed. There's more to reality than what your society has told you. Okay, but if you still have the ability to be selfish and or to go about your day disconnected from the earth except on weekends and holidays, then there's a problem. That ain't it. So this brings me around to Twitter. And someone on Twitter who I recognized the name, and but I don't remember if I've interacted with this person or not, but I suspect that I have. I feel like our little Twitter conversation has a tinge of, like he's expecting me to suddenly become a jerk. Like, maybe we've had an encounter before, maybe we've had it out, a beef or something, and I just don't remember. But it started off as a thread about Whitley Strieber. I guess there's a photo of the lady on from the communion cover with some notes on it about how she should look or something. I'm not really sure. I couldn't really read what these notes were. I don't even know if Whitley wrote them or the artist who did the cover wrote them or what. Doesn't really matter. I mean, what this person and their friends were asking was, did Whitley have a version of the cover that looked different than the actual cover? And if so, you know, the implication there or the question there is, was he lying about his experiences? And so I chimed in just to clear the air and say, listen, Whitley has said, and I believe said publicly, I think probably during the Bill Chalker Hair of the Alien, you know, when that book came out that time, I don't know if it was during that interview or what, but you know, he has said publicly, at least that, that the woman, the visitor had some hair, and that in certain other details, he has stripped away, so that if he ever found someone who with the exact same experience of these people, he would know that they were authentic. You know, at least that was the thinking back in the 80s was, and I mean, that makes perfect sense to me. It's like, yeah, you hide some details, that are something only a true experiencer of that being would know. But it doesn't take away from the authenticity, obviously, of that book cover, because so many people connected with it. And so I think the basic sort of, I don't know if archetypal is the right word, but the basic elements of the portrait that connect with experiencers in such a deep way, in a fundamental sort of subconscious way, are there in that. I mean, there's no denying that. Look at the effect of that on even you, most of you out there listening. So I think in this case, you can have your cake and eat it too. You can keep some of the details, the little details that only a true experiencer of that being would know, a secret. And you can still represent that visitor in a way that is real enough that it connects with people. So I just wanted to throw that out there, that not only was there no real lie or cover up and, you know, just making it up, the whole thing up, but that that he had actually spoken about that. And so then we, me and the, one of these people, get into a little conversation, a nice conversation about, he had some questions about my experiences and I tried to answer them to the best of my ability. But then he actually asked me a really interesting question. Like, I rarely do I get interesting questions about me. You know what I mean? Like deep questions that I have to actually think about for a second. And I'll just read it here. And I told him I would do this. This is someone who goes by the name Higher Ground. Says, listening to you now, as opposed to, say, a decade ago, the transformative process of particular UFO experiences and in-depth research on the subject is, in my opinion, on full display. And I'd like to ask a question. Do you ever feel you've become more fully human, in a sense, because of it? So he's saying, like, over the course of a decade, there's been a transformative process of some experiences in my life of the UFO variety and in-depth research that I guess he thinks I've become a better person as a result. And he's wondering if I feel that way. Like, have I become more fully human, in a sense, because of my research and because of my experiences? And I give a response that is, you know, a short and sweet Twitter response, as short and sweet as I can make it. But also I said, maybe I would talk about it on the show and expand on it. So let's just do that instead of me reading my response. If the question is, have I changed because of my experiences? And if you're an experiencer out there, put this question to yourself. Has it made you more wholly human? Non-subscribers, our time is up. Please click that subscribe tab. Get the rest of this. Get all of the experience. Get all of Dreamland. Get all of everything Unknown Country has to offer for a pittance of a price. Nothing's at stake here. Just your immortal soul. Okay, maybe not that. But I think you may get quite a bit out of the rest of this episode. So if for no other reason, click that subscribe tab and get a free month of other stuff for just paying to listen to the rest of this. Think of it that way. 'Tis the season. And either way, I will see you next week for another edition of The Experience. Take care.